As we saw in the last video, one of the main points of disagreement between defenders and opponents of the Bloomberg Soda Law concerns the extent to which people's actions are the result of rational deliberation. Defenders of the Bloomberg Soda Law, such as Bloomberg himself, play up the degree to which our eating behaviors are influenced by our environment, while opponents argue that people are much more rational and in control of what they eat than defenders suggest. Conley, as you've now seen, sides firmly with the defenders of the Bloomberg Soda Law. She argues that psychology has shown that it is a mistake to view ourselves as free, rational beings who are totally capable of making all the decisions we need to in order to create a good life. In her view, we're bad enough at deciding how best to achieve what we want that the government should force us to make better choices. Conley's evidence that we are bad at figuring out how to get what we want does not rely primarily on experiments like Wonsink's, which show that our eating behavior is determined in large part by our environment, although Conley does appeal to that type of experiment in some of her other work. Instead, in this article, she focuses primarily on the existence of cognitive biases, that is, patterns of cognitive error that systematically lead us astray. She mentions three. First, we procrastinate even when we know that we shouldn't. Second, we are biased towards the status quo, that is, the way we currently do things, and we are reluctant to change, even when there's no good reason to continue to do things the way we always have. Finally, Conley mentions that we tend to underestimate the chance that bad things will happen to us. Conley believes that these cognitive biases are so misleading that people are not well equipped to satisfy their desires, at least in many cases. Now, suppose that Conley's right about this. What follows? According to Conley, what follows is that the government is often justified in enacting laws, like the Bloomberg Soda Law, that force people to make good decisions they wouldn't otherwise make. Now, it's very important to note that Conley does not say that the government would be justified in enacting any law whatsoever that would force people to make good decisions they wouldn't otherwise make. She believes that there are limits to what the government can reasonably do. For example, the government shouldn't enact a law that forces us to exercise every day and give up all meat, sugar, and salt. Why shouldn't the government enact such a law? Because, Conley says, a law like this would be too painful and therefore wouldn't be a good law. She says, quote, successful paternalistic laws are done on the basis of a cost-benefit analysis. To make these analyses is something the government has the resources to do, just as now it sets automobile construction standards while considering both the need for affordability and the desire for safety. Do we care so much about our health that we want to be forced to go to aerobics every day and give up all meat, sugar, and salt? No, but in this case, it's just some extra soda. Now, one question to think about here is whether Conley has really answered the worry that the Bloomberg Soda Law cannot be justified without also justifying a whole array of objectionably paternalistic laws. Conley says that a law requiring us to exercise every day and give up all meat, sugar, and salt would be too painful, and that's why the government couldn't reasonably enact such a law. But she doesn't say much to explain why enacting a law like this would be too painful. One thing to think about here is how Conley might argue that enacting a law banning meat, sugar, and salt and requiring daily exercise would be too painful. Would it be too painful to enact such a law because exercise is always painful to some degree? It's not clear that would be a good argument. Even if exercise always is painful, on balance, it still makes sense to exercise, even when this pain is taken into consideration. That's why it's true that everyone who is medically able to should exercise. But if that argument wouldn't justify the claim that a law requiring daily exercise would be too painful, then, well, what argument would? This question needs to be answered if Conley is to show that opponents of the Bloomberg Law are wrong that the law puts us on a slippery slope towards excessive and intrusive governmental regulation.